Hi. Today we will be giving a talk on extending Kubernetes using custom controllers. So before we get started, I would like to ask you all a few questions. So how many of you find vanilla Kubernetes insufficient for your use cases? Any hands? Okay, not too many. How many of you have worked with operators and found them intimidating to use? Okay, a few. Finally, how many of you have worked with the Kubernetes API and built a custom solution? Okay, two people right there, a few here. Okay, so judging the sentiment in the room, I think we can actually agree Kubernetes controllers and working with Kubernetes API server can be quite hard. This talk will focus on how can we make it easier to work with, so let's learn to do it the easy way.
My name is Harsh. I work with the infrastructure team at Grofers, and I think John.
Hi, I'm John Sundharam. I work as a site reliability engineer at LinkedIn.
Okay, so I think we are good to go. We are ready to start. So we'll do a short start on what we need to know before we start the session. So I'm working with the assumption that most people know what basic Kubernetes constructs are, what is a pod, what is a service, what is a deployment. So what we are trying to do here, we'll try to brush up some of the components you need to know before you can understand shared informers, controller runtimes, and operators. So there is a concept in Kubernetes of events and watches. So to read what is written here, to enable clients to build a model of the current state of cluster, all Kubernetes object resource types are required to support a watch. Every Kubernetes object has a resource version field representing the version of that resource. When retrieving a collection of resources, which may be either namespace bound or cluster bound, the response from the server will contain a resource version, and we can use that to initiate a watch. So that's quite a mouthful, so we'll try to simplify this. So if we try to put it very simply, any event that occurs in your cluster or any change that occurs in your cluster technically triggers an event behind. For example, when you try to create a new pod, there's an event that triggers behind and the scheduler comes to know that, okay, a new deployment has come up, I need to schedule the pods for this thing. So these kind of events are called add events. There are multiple events like add events, update events, delete events. So the Kubernetes by design collects all these events into a centralized store from where either other components or a client can pull these events to perform actions. To listen for these events, you need a watcher. So what a watcher does is that you specify a type of resource and a watcher can look for events that are occurring for that particular resource. Based on the events that you're getting, you can write business logic that can filter them and help you take action on those things. So we discussed in the last slide about events and watches. So there's a concept of shared informers. So since every object supports a watch construct and we can filter events through that, but these events are available at the API server. Since the cluster itself runs at an API server level, it doesn't know what kind of clients are connected to it. So all these events are at the API server. If I want to consume these events through a client, I must construct a shared informer. So its shared informer is present in the client Go library. What it means is that it can help my custom code get some events from the API server and allow me to write business logic on specific events types like add a event, create event, or delete event. So this is a small example on how do we write a shared informer. So I'm assuming some of you may not be familiar with the client Go library, but if you want to create a shared informer, the process is as simple as sharedinformer.core v1. The resource type that you want to create it for. So shared informer here is a resource that allows us to listen for events. Core v1 is the API that we are trying to listen for. And resource may be a pod, may be a service, may be a deployment for which I want to filter out the events. So again, if you want to create a shared informer at a code level, you have initialized your informer. Now you want to take actions on the events that are happening. So the first type of event that you can handle is an add event. So add event means when something new is added to my cluster configuration, like a deployment that you just created which was not existing before. So these type of events are add events, and to handle them, you use the add func functionality. And the function that I've written here, there you'll write the business logic to handle this event. Technically, you'll not write the business logic there. We'll come to that later, but I'm simplifying it right now. Similarly, for any event that triggers an update, for example, there was a deployment already existing in your cluster and you decided to scale it up, or you decided to change the image of the deployment, you handle that business logic through an update func. And if you decide to delete something from your cluster, like you decided to delete a service or a deployment, you'd use a delete func to handle the business logic for that. So writing controllers is tough. There's a lot of business logic to understand. So it is very tough. So what should we do? So we need simple solutions that can simplify this. So I think John is going to take you through a very simple approach on how we can do it. I'll take it from there. So Go code is slightly tough to write. I mean, for people who are coming from Python or some other languages, functional languages, Go code can be slightly intimidating at first. And when you're working with a complex system like Kubernetes, which has multiple libraries, client-side and server-side libraries, it can be challenging. So people created controller runtime. So controller runtime is a set of libraries that allows someone who has just started working with Kubernetes achieve the best practices. So it is a set of rules, set of logics that you can straight away use to create your controllers, but it also does not enforce them upon you. It gives you the option. You may choose to use it, you may choose to override it. So it defines very easy helpers for common use cases for building CRDs that are built on top of the Kubernetes API abstractions. So the goal behind this thing is that common use cases should be easy for a person to implement, yet there must be flexibility to implement uncommon use cases. So in general, it's more biased towards like the best practices that people should know about writing a controller. So when we try to implement a shared informer through a code, it can be very challenging because anybody here has seen the code for any of the controllers, replication controller, cron job controller, anybody? Okay, some of us. So I think you guys will agree that controllers can be huge with more than 400 lines of code, thousands of lines of code, and most of it is boilerplate. So it helps. So it gives you a set of clients also, the controller runtime that you can use, consume, and write your own business logic. It is highly opinionated to some people, or it's slightly opinionated. So the reason behind that is so that you don't form your own opinions, you agree to what the community has agreed to. It is one of the more popular approaches to how modern controllers should be written, especially third-party controllers. And it is slightly better than to use native Kubernetes constructs.
Okay, so we shall now give you a brief overview of how controllers can be written using controller runtime. And these are generic constructs that essentially every controller that you write with controller runtime shall use. Let's get started. So the first step to writing a custom controller is to write a manager. A manager is responsible for running multiple controllers. It can handle leader elections, and it can also deal with graceful termination of the controller using signal handling. Once you register your controller to a manager, it starts listening to events and starts processing them using the provided event handler. The actual business logic for reconciling requests is present in the reconciler. A reconciler is meant to work with only one type of resource. a reconciler receives a reconcile request from a work queue, processes that request, and returns a reconcile result. For a reconciler to make changes to the cluster state, it needs to access control plane resources via client. So controller runtime provides its own clients that act as wrappers over API calls that go to the Kubernetes API server. Okay. In the following slide, we attempt to bring all these components together using an architecture diagram. So this is like what it actually looks like inside controller runtime. So once we have our controller and manager set up, we call the watch function on the controller. Watch takes events provided by a source and uses the event handler to unqueue reconcile requests in response to the events. This also talks about predicates, which are used by controllers to filter events before they are provided to the event handlers. We'll talk more about the event handlers later during when we do a code walkthrough. The events, once they go through the event handler, they go into a Delta FIFO work queue, which automatically gets rid of duplicates. By default, only one reconciler is run, but this is configurable by using a max concurrent reconciles parameter on the controller. A reconciler returns a reconcile request, a reconciler result, which allows us to requeue the event. And we can also requeue the event with an optional delay. This can be useful, for example, if for whatever reason there are some issues with the API server, or you can intermittently not get access to the object, you can just add it with a delay. That depends totally on your controller.
So I think everybody in this room understands a little bit on how controllers are supposed to work. What is the role of a manager? What is a controller? And what exactly is a reconciler? Reconciler is the business logic. So I think we'll try to go through a very short code walkthrough on how to write a very basic controller. It doesn't satisfy a business use case, but provides a solid boiler point for somebody who wants to understand the functionality of controllers. So what we are trying to do here is that we'll try to write a controller that will send out a Slack notification anytime a pod crashes in my container. Is the code visible to everybody? Okay. So before we can create a controller, we need a manager. A manager is responsible because manager is the logic that is responsible for triggering the controllers. Every controller is run by a manager, technically. So it sets up a lot of things in the background, like it provides the client, caches, and a lot of dependencies that a controller needs to run. Managers are also responsible for handling graceful shutdowns. Handling things like sick kills, SIGINTs, or any other kind of ungraceful termination that may occur to your controller, so you need to handle the business logic accordingly. So how do we create a manager? It's pretty simple. You go and create an object, not an object technically, you create a new instance of manager and you pass it some configuration. So you have to pass the Kubernetes cluster config here, the get config or die, either tries to get your local kube config or gets the in-cluster config, depending on how it's running. So what it does here is that we can pass a certain set of parameters, like what will be the leader election logics, what will be the sync period. The sync period is technically when should it reconcile your cluster state. So anytime an event is happening, a drift is created between what should be in your cluster and what is running in your cluster. That drift is what we are trying to reconcile using a controller. For example, you said that any time a pod is created, I want a Slack notification. So the drift here is that the pod has been created, but the Slack notification has not been triggered. To reconcile it, a reconciler will be called, which will send out the Slack notification. So for the sake of this demo, we'll continue to use default parameters of the manager. We'll not try to define some custom parameters. So this is how we are going to set up the actual controller. We'll call a new function. So we'll try to pass it the manager that we created, because every controller needs to be bound to a manager. So this again has a set of optional parameters that you can leave out. The most important parameter when you're trying to create a controller is again the reconciler, because it has the business logic. I'm stressing on this again and again because most new people think that controller actually contains the business logic to do the changes. It does not, and it should not. That's a wrong practice. It's always good to use a reconciler. So anytime the controller detects, okay, I have found some drift in the cluster, it's going to call your reconcile logic. That is how system works. So when we are trying to show a demo around this, you'll see it in action. It's also possible to do some advanced tweaking with your It's also possible to do some advanced tweaking with your reconciler logics. You can have things like more than one reconciler running at a time using things like max concurrent reconcilers. By default, that value is one. So I think John will guide you further here.
Okay, so now that we have a controller set up, we can call watch on it. Watch takes events provided by a source and uses event handler to enqueue reconcile requests in response to the events. Since we are watching objects of kind pod, we provide core v1 pod as a type here. I would actually like to reiterate what we are trying to do here in the code walkthrough. We are trying to build a simple controller which would watch over. So you can have a pod. A pod can have multiple containers in it. What we are trying to do is, as soon as a container in a pod crashes, we are trying to send a Slack notification. And we'll show you how this actually gets implemented. We'll also show you how it actually gets deployed on a cluster. But yeah, I'll focus more on the code walkthrough right now. So the controller runtime provides three implementations for event handlers. The simplest kind of event handler provided is onQueue request for object. It onQueues a request containing the name and namespace of the object that is the source of the event. Another commonly used event handler is onQueue request for owner. It onQueues request for the owners of an object. For example, if you have a deployment, you can onQueue a deployment by using a replica set as the source. Same. You can deploy. You can onQueue a replica set by using a pod as the source. While these may be enough for most use cases, it's non-trivial to implement custom event handlers by implementing the event handler interface inside controller runtime. A possible use case for this is to provide different implementations for add, update, and delete events instead of a common reconcile function. It's important to note that the creators of controller runtime think of it as an anti-pattern because they want a single, they recommend a single reconciler function so that a reconciler is always idempotent. Okay. Okay, and now instead of having to build the controller separately, like setting a watch on it, you can also use like the builder, which is also part of controller runtime. What it does is it wraps other controller runtime libraries and exposes simple patterns for building common controllers. This is like a much simpler way to get started. Okay, and now, a controller must be started by, just a sec. Good. Okay, a controller must be started by calling start on the manager. The setup signal handler registers for sigterm and sigint signals. A stop channel is returned, which is closed on one of these signals. If a second signal is caught, the program gets terminated with an exit code 1. Okay, so now we come to the crux, the actual business logic where everything happens. So with all the necessary components in place, we can now write our reconciler. A reconciler implements a function which takes a reconcile request containing the name and namespace of the object to reconcile. It reconciles the object and returns a response or an error indicating whether to requeue for a second round of processing. The reconciler request uses the namespace name of an object we need to work with. We use controller runtime's client to connect to the Kubernetes cluster and get the current object. Since a delete event would also trigger the reconciler, it's important to cater for this. We can handle this specifically using errors is not found. I'll just show that to you. Once you cater for the delete event, you also what our reconciler here actually does is it loops through all the containers. It loops through all the containers in a pod and tries checking the restart status of it, if it got restarted. If it did, it would go ahead and send a Slack notification to us. We can also show you what this would look like and like on a cluster. Just let me open VS Code for that. We'll just give you a very quick walkthrough of what we built here. So we set up our logger, we set up our manager as we showed you. We then go ahead, set up our controller, put a watch on it. We watch for pods, so that's what's here. We onQueue request for objects because we are trying to onQueue pods. We don't need like a parent of it. We then set up the signal handling, and that's actually as easy as it is. You just need to go and add a reconciler to it. So we actually go ahead, and this is what I was trying to show you. This is how you can deal for if a delete event happened, that object would not actually be there, so you can deal with it here. If there is some error fetching, you can actually requeue it so that it can get processed later. And this is the actual business logic of our program. What it does is it just goes through all the containers in a pod, checks if it's restarted, and if it has restarted, it sends a Slack notification. That's pretty much it. I think we may have a little time for a demo, so let's try seeing if we can get there. Okay. Let's try. So you can actually run, before I show that, I'll start to show you. You can actually run this inside your cluster using something like this. You would have to set up a service account for your pod because it needs to make calls to the API server. You provide a role and you let it list get and watch pods. You then create a role binding which would bind the service account to your role. And finally, you do the deployment. You don't need multiple replicas. And this would run the controller over the cluster itself. For the sake of the demo, I would just run it directly. It would just connect to our cluster. So, okay, let's try doing this. Yeah, so it has gone ahead, sets up manager, sets up controller, watches pods. It's starting the manager. Now I would actually go ahead and so give me a sec. I have an example pod here. It would go ahead and crash quickly so that this demo can go better for us. Let's see. Kubectl apply -f and example pod. Yeah, that should, oh, there was actually one already. Let's delete that. Yep. let's apply that back. Okay, and let's just check if we got the notification. So as soon as this controller, as soon as this container restarts, which we can check with kubectl get pods hyphen w. Okay, I think it should have crashed by now. Controller demo running, completed, yeah. Just a sec. Oh yeah, the Kubernetes demo. Yeah, perfect. So yeah, that's what we were trying to show. Like it would send us a notification for the crashed container. So that's it for the demo. And thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Are there any questions anyone wants to ask? We are open to them, but I think we are very out of time. See you all at lunch. Thank you.